final passages of the first chapter, what remains is for Don Quixote to settle the question of his own name as well as that of his mistress. Again, the narrator refers to other authors of this very true story, planting a problem that will plague us throughout the novel. What was Don Quixote's name before he went crazy? Who knows? Some say Quixada, others Quexada, finally identifying as he did initially with Amadís of Gaul. Our Hidalgo decides to call himself Don Quixote de la Mancha in honor of his lineage and his country. This all sounds ridiculous. Quixote sounds somewhat derogatory, even diminutive, and La Mancha is not exactly a glorious region, but rather dry, sad, and poor, just like our hero. In fact, if we consider one literal meaning of La Mancha, the stain in English, then Don Quixote has chosen a name indicating filth, contamination, maybe some disgrace in the past relating to racial or moral impurity. Finally, we come to the part of the exposition dedicated to Dulcinea. Again, this is deceptively simple. Don Quixote needs a lady to whom to dedicate his exploits, so he chooses a peasant, Aldonza Lorenzo, who lives in a neighboring village and with whom he appears already to be in love. He gives her a name as wonderful sounding as his own and that of his horse, Dulcinea del Toboso. Let's give Dulcinea her due, however. She represents a universal motivation, love. Perhaps for this reason, Dulcinea merges with stylistic complexity. We have here the first dialogue in a novel that is famously dialogical, a novel that contains dialogues in myriad forms, letters, debates, challenges, discussions within stories that are told by characters who are in dialogue with still other characters, which are then debated by yet other characters and even multiple narrators. It turns out that the first dialogue of this novel takes place inside Don Quixote's head. Don Quixote, according to the narrator, said unto himself, "Recall that the first case of direct discourse, that is, a quotation as such, was a ridiculously twisted passage attributed to Feliciano de Silva, an author of romances of chivalry. Now we witness the effect of that discourse. This time, the surrounding indirect discourse yields to a direct interior quotation." In other words, the narrator quotes not only what a character says, but what he says to himself. Moreover, this inner dialogue contains within it additional quotations, because Don Quixote imagines the voice of a giant whom he has beaten and then sent to Dulcinea to proclaim his victory. Wouldn't it be proper to have someone to whom to send him so that upon entering and falling to his knees before my sweet lady, he might say with a humble and defeated voice, "I, madam, am but the giant Caraculiambro, lord of the island Malindrania, beaten in single combat by the never sufficiently admired knight Don Quixote de la Mancha, who has commanded me to present myself before your grace, that your highness might dispose of me as she please." Direct speech, containing further direct speech, Cervantine narrative is fantastic in and of itself. And in the first chapter, it takes flight precisely at the first reference to Dulcinea. By the way, from where does this desire on the part of a 50-year-old man for a young woman come? Just books of chivalry? Is there not something in the air? Could this lust have been generated by the female presences in his own home? These and other questions related to love and passionate desire will occupy us throughout the novel. To sum up, our Hidalgo's situation is unfortunate, even desperate. Decay, we might say, entropy is everywhere, poverty and pathos. Don Quixote is mismanaging his finances, liquidating assets to buy books of chivalry. Similarly, his horse is rotting from the ground up, like the currency of the Spanish Empire that Don Quixote wants to return to its former glory. But, and here lies the genius of Cervantes, this is all comical. Remember how Don Quixote learns not to test his helmet a second time, and the ridiculous and violent arguments Don Quixote has had with the barber and the priest regarding which knight is the knightliest of all knights. We imagine Don Quixote walking back and forth, going crazy, trying to interpret the twisted phrases of Feliciano de Silva. "The reason of unreason, which has overtaken my reason, weakens my reason, such that it is with reason that I may complain of your beauty." What the hell does that mean? Cervantes is already playing with his readers. And finally, we must admit that a certain universality prevails here. An old man is frustrated by his boring life and tired of being useless. On top of that, he's in love. Who has never been in love and who has not felt the need to prove their worth? Most importantly, Don Quixote strives to resist the entropies of life, the decay of his body, the decay of his mind, his finances, even that of the whole world, at least until he rules the kingdom of Trebizond on the south coast of the Black Sea. And he has in his mind the fantastic idea of going out and doing something good for the betterment of all. He wants to put everything back in its proper and familiar place. And he is going to try, come what may.